This podcast is rated E for explicit. Bitter, sweet, both fulfilling and incomplete. Changed in ways we can't yet speak. Thoughts of days we got a peek at each other. We recognized parts of ourselves in each other. At times I was happy to let them see. Even the most vulnerable parts of me. Other times when I recoiled to a state of closure, I was saddened to have had to return, because sometimes the cost of being open is being burned. Sometimes good times take a turn, and it leaves you to question if what it cost was worth what you earned. Lately, that's been a painful exercise to discern. I've been thinking a lot about these dualities in which we must exist, and how we govern ourselves around ways in which they persist. I shared this because I wanted you to understand the mindset that I was in when I sat down for this interview with Behind the Brand.
FM New Haven, myself, Prestige, with my partner in crime, Long Island Rays, Elm City Made, EZ Blues, is in the building doing his little awesome dance on Behind the Brand. We got Akil Johnson talking about his podcast, The Poet God, which I'm really excited about. I haven't seen this man since college. It's been a long time. I think it was like 2005. My, the years have gone by. It's about 6 years ever since I saw him. And it's crazy because when I was talking to him like back in college, I remember one time we had a good like 2 to 3 hour conversation with a good friend of ours, Raul Douglas. And we were talking like way back then. It was in Southern Connecticut, easy. And we were talking about just trying to make it out of life. We didn't know what we really wanted, but we were just talking about that. And it was just a whole bunch of empowerment. And so I'm really happy just to have him here today. And I think everything is really coming in full circle.
You met me in the midst of many things. Shedding skin, sprout wings, looking at life as a spiritual being through a human lens, having conversations with God about so many things. This show is your invitation. The Poet God is the conversation. I wasn't feeling very open at the time of this interview. I was in a state of deep assessment and reflection. But when Preston reminded me it was on the schedule, I decided to go into it as open as I could, yet without expectation. As he said, we hadn't spoken to each other in years, but like many who have crossed my path and left an impression, I was curious about where his path had taken him as he re-emerged from the shadows of a friendship with a mutual friend.
Thanks for being part of the show, man. You have a great personality, and I did happen to listen to a little bit of your podcast. One thing I love about it, it's motivational. You always want to try to have everyone just motivate themselves to be a better human being.
But of course, he was the one asking the questions. So sit back and enjoy the ride. This is an unexpected episode of Inside the Mind of a Poet, Dissecting Dualities.
Started in just the world of entertainment and mass media. Just give a brief introduction to our audience. Go right ahead.
Well, I think it was really more about a way to for me to express the things that were going on within my life, and making sense of the hardships and pains and challenges that I was facing as a teenager when I first started to really get into expressing myself through writing and finding my voice in that form. And that naturally progressed to opportunities that materialized in different forms of media. It wasn't necessarily about radio or television,
mm-hmm.
or writing in a newspaper. It was just me wanting to articulate as best as I could,
okay.
What I was experiencing as a human being, and other people, obviously, in my community who had the opportunity to read the poems that I used to write, back in the day. It was because of one of those people being an editor of one of the newspapers in the Virgin Islands. He kind of gave me an opportunity to write a column, and I took him up on that. And that was kind of really the beginning of it being shared in a big way with a lot of other people who I would never have the opportunity to meet in person, but I sure heard from a lot of them in terms of what they felt, how what I was writing affected them and so forth. And I think it just became my reality because of the opportunity. And I just kind of evolved as a writer. And I hearing you say the word entertainment, I'd never think of it that way, because I don't think of myself as an entertainer. That doesn't even register with me on any level. It's just more about, I'm just somebody who's sharing, who's just sharing my life, and it happens to be in this way, and it happens to materialize in this form. And that's where I'm coming from. I'm not thinking about entertaining anybody, mm-hmm. you know.
Okay. So. Is teacher more of a better word?
I guess I feel like we all can be teachers, mm-hmm. for each other, whether intentionally or unintentionally,
mm-hmm.
Depending on the mindset that you have in general about life. Because I do see myself as both a student and a teacher, just as I would consider you to be, just as I would go into whatever interactions that we've had, and think about what I took away from those experiences, what I learned about myself as a human being through observing you as a human being. And so that's been a lot of my mindset, because I'm trying to also understand myself as a human being. So a lot of that happens through what I encounter and experience with other people.
Mm. That's true. That is definitely so, mm-hmm. true. And that's what pretty much just life is, man. We're all learning every day. We are all students. And I really think people tend to forget that, especially when it comes to big ego and like all these like crazy attitudes. I mean, Ethan and I saw it just being in the whole, independent music scene for a little bit. We've seen all these attitudes, and you really forget where you come from. And you're not really as that humble anymore. You know, like people not really are not getting it so much.
Right.
I'm really happy that you see that. And I like the fact how you said you're not an entertainer. Like it's more to that. Your message is more than just, entertaining. It's bigger than just pressing play. What are you getting out of the show? You can listen to a show. You can be, satisfied with what you're seeing, but what are you really learning from it? That's actually
exactly.
a good mindset to actually just put out for the listeners. Like if you talk to somebody just about your product, okay, what did you learn from it? What did you get out of it? Well, how can I be better in the next show. You know what I'm saying? Like, I think a lot of people kind of lose the criticism when it comes behind that.
Our conversation deepened as I shared a story about a coworker I shared this podcast with. In reflection on that, I touched on something I've been thinking a lot about lately, which is that our relationships are only as deep and as rich and as authentic as we give them the safety to be.
When people find out that they can have a certain level of conversation with you or interaction with you,
right,
they'll start to peel back the layers and they'll start to open up and they'll start to let you see them, mm-hmm. perhaps in a way that they don't normally feel safe to be seen. But I was saying to him in that conversation that the journey with the podcast for me began with a willingness to be naked and be transparent and be as authentic as I know how to be in that moment. And I felt like God was asking me to, that if I wasn't going to be willing to do that, that don't even do it, because mm-hmm. it wasn't going to be about cranking out episode after episode after episode just to fill a particular time. It's going to be about taking time to understand what it is that you're saying, what you want to say, what you need to say, and taking time to say it as clear and as concise as possible. And so sometimes that's just takes time. And if it's, you know, I can't rush that process. And so one of my main struggles in doing the podcast is balancing consistency with authenticity. Because for me, those two things, you know, they can't be one without the other, you know. And sometimes I fail to a certain degree, mm-hmm. and sometimes I succeed to a certain degree, but you know, it's just what it is, you know, just part of what that experience is for me.
Go ahead, Izzy.
Well, no, I wanted to make, to kind of reinforce those points. You know, what you're doing is being fearless. And you're, you know, and I love how you distinguish where this is not entertainment, you know, because if it was entertainment, we would have to play by a certain amount of rules. It would have to be wrapped up within 30 minutes. It would have to be weekly. It would have to, you know, that is how we as a society are programmed to digest, you know, what we are fed on a mass consumer market, and make it as quick as possible, make it as short as possible. And that true struggle is to live as transparent as possible and to yourself bring down these walls that we as a society have trained to put up, you know, and from our living experiences have then culturally had to have extra layers on there because of A, B, C, and we are not afraid to get involved in uncomfortable conversations. So I can fully say that yours and Preston's journey is not the same as mine, because I had to put up less barriers. Mm-hmm. Although I still had to put up a ton of barriers because I am, you know, cis, straight, white, male, I have to put up less barriers than other people do, you know, and that is the very true reality. Mm-hmm. And the fact that you can live your truth out in the mass market, because that's really, you know, what this space of the internet is. It's a full mass market, and you do it unlike, say, a Kardashian, where there's edits, you know, where they're only showing, you know, the top good parts of this week, month, and or year. Mm-hmm. You know, you're doing it like, look, I woke up today, I did what I did, this is how it was, this is how my day this is how my day changed me, this is how I've changed my day. And mm-hmm. you know, it is such an incredible balance, and it is that tightrope walk of saying, hey, but if I say I did it this way, maybe more people will listen in, or it'll be that hook to drag them back in. And this is what I love about being independent. And I will constantly say this: if you had mass consumerism behind you, you would have to be a lot more filtered. Mm-hmm. Because you do not have the freedom of being independent. You know, from a music point of view, you have more freedom when you own your own masters.
Right.
You know, and you own your brand. So you are, and I want to commend you for taking that and being authentic and knowing that that is the direction in which your brand comes from and will stay. So thank you for that.
Thank you, Easy Blues. And on that note, we'll be right back after these messages.
Someone asked me if I were actually wanting to engage in sexual activity, and I said no, which was a lie, because I was horny. I just didn't want to have sex with that person.
Sometimes we lie because it's tradition.
But who wants to be, who honestly wants to be with a man who you don't respect enough to tell the truth?
Other times because the truth has denied us its permission, giving way to lies of omission.
There is a reason why I don't get on Zoom calls until they know me. I mean, in terms of like showing my face. That is that lie of omission. I need for them to respect me by my voice first before they say, oh, it's a black guy.
Because we won't dare compromise our position.
That is the lie that religiosity, not religion, religiosity has told people.
That's such BS.
Sometimes a lie is born of contrition for a truth that's a thorn in our ambitions.
I've never in my old days used to be the type of person who wanted to be lied to. But this is one of those cases where lied to me.
Listen to episodes 10 and 11, Sometimes a Lie and Lie to Me, as we unpack the many reasons why we lie.
I probably lie most with lies of omission. And I don't feel bad about it.
Listen to the Poet God podcast on Apple, Google, Spotify, or your favorite podcasting app. And a quick search of the Poet God on Twitter and Instagram will connect you to just what we have on tap. And if you're not that social, at thepoetgod.com, we got your back. As I continue my conversation with Behind the Brand, I talk about the business of podcasting and what it means to podcast as art.
Do you really feel today we're in a fast food market when it comes to just people just getting entertainment from themselves, like, you know, music, radio shows, podcasts and stuff like that? Because of how you talked about just earlier in this broadcast, you take your time with this. It's not just, you know, this week I'm going to have this week I'm going to have that. It really takes time to make a good product because you're representing yourself in your true form to your audience. Do you feel everything is just so just rushed when it comes to just this field that we're in, when it comes to podcasting and just media right now today?
Yeah. And, you know, I depending on what kind of podcast it is.
Okay.
I think that the appropriate emphasis on frequency is necessary depending. With what I'm doing, I don't see how that would be possible to just, it's a very delicate dance. Like I like to kind of use the term like podcasting as art. In my particular case, and because there is that level of creativity going into it, and so if I was doing a news show, then obviously that really doesn't necessarily need to apply there. Mm-hmm. Although I could use an example for one of my favorite podcasts is on that kind of thing, like the New York Times, the Daily. I think they do an excellent job in balancing, you know, bringing the news to people, but also telling the backstory and doing it in a way that feels like really, but then again, they do have a massive amount of staff, you know,
right.
It's just me. I mean, and if perhaps if I had that, I could balance that, you know, consistency, artistry, art thing a little bit more. But I think you do the best as you can with what you have, the best Absolutely. That you can. And you kind of go from there and do it to the highest capacity that you're going to do it, and then just surrender it and hope that mm-hmm. people receive it on the other end the way that you intended to do it. But to answer your question more specifically, I do think it just depends on the intent of right. the content. Where you're going to be on the spectrum, because, you know, it really has a lot to do with that. And so.
And doing everything that is required of me to produce this podcast, I often say I wear many hats. But in thinking about that further, I realize I really don't get to take one off while wearing the other. I wear them all at the same time, and while I certainly love the experience and the gifts of that, I also see the value of being able to broaden the canvas upon which this art is created, and allowing others to join and share that experience with me.
One episode I didn't really get to hear is one called Surrender, Remember. Want you to articulate and investigate the journey of your soul and challenges of the human experience. Just give a little bit of our audience a little bit of teaser of what you're trying to let the audience listen to.
It is me talking about the journey of becoming aligned within yourself, with your physical and spiritual worlds and your physical and spiritual identities. And the more I grow as a person, the needs and desires of my soul have become less patient with being put on the back burner for the desires and needs of my physical body. And so in that poem, I'm talking about, I use these metaphors of the eagle and the snail, the eagle representing the soul and the spirit, and the snail representing the physical, and them finding their way to each other. And coming to a space where they're realizing the value that is held in both experiences as vastly different as they are, and finding and exchanging wisdom of both those journeys, and finding commonality and harmony. And making peace with the struggles of each of those. And so that's what that poem is talking about, that journey of that I've been experiencing within myself. So it's a lot. It's a lot. But I've been carrying that for quite some time, and I'm so happy to have finally gotten that out. And again, that poem is a really good example of something not being, you can't rush it.
Nah.
Because everything that has happened in my life went into what I was able to say there, you know?
Right.
And so telling me that you have a deadline in 2 weeks for the next episode just doesn't compute.
It's so true, because really, and I'm hoping the audience truly, truly understands this. You're speaking about your own personal journey of healing. Mm-hmm. Yes. And to be able to speak about that properly, you actually have to engage in the journey of healing. Mm-hmm. And what a lot of people don't seem to understand, you know, healing isn't necessarily a comfortable journey. You know, let's, for the person that doesn't understand the emotional pain, let's look at a physical pain. Mm-hmm. If you break your leg, it's going to hurt before it can get better. And then once that cast comes off, you have to do physical therapy to retrain the muscles, and that's going to hurt to get better. So to think, to heal from our emotional trauma, to heal from our environmental trauma, if you think it's not going to be a painful process, you are sadly mistaken. And when you are someone like yourself who is fearless enough to live that pain in front of a microphone or in front of a pen, you know, it really is a valuable thing. You know, what I loved about music growing up was it made me understand that I wasn't the only one. I wasn't the only one to have dark thoughts. I wasn't the only one to feel pain. You know, there's this incredible book, High Fidelity, which became a movie. And the opening line from the movie is, you know, did I listen to pop music because I was miserable, or was I miserable because I listened to pop music? But for me, it was, I listened to some stuff that's dealing with some pain aspect because it made me feel not alone. You know, and as an artist, now that is my goal, is to make that other child, that kid, that human being, not feel alone in their darkest moment. And to meet someone like yourself who is willing to live those dark moments and live the healing process, which is so painful, which is so gut-wrenching at points. I want to thank you for that. And I really want to highlight that in this story, you know, because I really think that that's what people need to understand and relate to, is the fact that you don't have that time frame. It's not going to be something that's just pushed out. You have to live through it to truly reflect on it. And that's a lot, man, that to do that in front of people. Like, I live a lot of my life in front of people. I do what I do. I personally, I'm a carny. It's the way it goes. But I do it from the point of humor, because that helps bring people's walls down, and then they can start to be real with me. You're doing it from the point of healing, from one of the most vulnerable points. And that should be commended. And I want you to really tell the audience what it's like to go through that journey.
Well, first of all, thank you so much for articulating that. I really felt that. Thank you. It is exhausting, you know, to be quite honest. It is so, so, so exhausting. But I feel like it is the work, the life's work of my soul. And so what I want to do more and more, my deepest prayer is to be able to do that full time. And as you talked about earlier, to be able to make a living from it while doing that, because I'm not driven by monetary stuff. Obviously you got to do what you need to pay the bills, but my happiness, joy, winning the lottery for me would be able to have enough to keep the lights on, but also to have enough to do what it is that I really am here to do and fulfill my purpose and be able to be free to do that 100%.
We'll be right back after these messages. My intention for this podcast is for it to be an enlightening experience of love. And from what I hear, that intention is being met loud and clear.
This was amazing. I wish every high school senior who's graduating can hear this, and every college graduate can hear this. This is super, super special, and I enjoyed it 100%.
I like where you are coming from, using the word God to communicate to people, because so many people have so many different ideals of God. You seem to be on a higher spiritual plane because you seem to have a personal connection, which is a great thing. We're all God's children, but some of us just do devilish things. I think what we're going through at these times right now with this coronavirus is teaching us we all need each other.
Indeed, we do. And it is with the support of people like you, I will continue to answer the call to share what God has given me. Because this is a gift I believe the world is meant to hear and see. As I continue my conversation on Behind a Brand with Prestige and Easy Blues, Easy Blues talks about what it really means to be an artist. And, oh yeah, that elephant in the room.
FM New Haven, Behind the Brand, myself, Prestige, and like I said your name before, Easy Blues. Akil Johnson is our guest on Behind the Brand. Continue, go right ahead, Easy.
I'm a musician, I'm a singer, and I have written those songs that I don't like to play live because that means I have to then relive that moment every single time. And I am a full body performer as per, it's not just a matter of me standing up there. I'm going to go through the range of emotions because someone paid to see me perform. If they wanted to just hear the song, they would listen to it on Spotify, and please do. But she pops, it is what it is. But what really comes down to is the performance aspect of it. And to truly do that, you've got to go through it again. You've got to relive that moment. And it stinks, and I'm not gonna boo hoo hoo because everyone's like, oh, whatever, and they think it's MTV Cribs, so you're crying over your $1 million. If I had $1 million, this would not be the studio that I'm shooting this from on an iPhone. Let's be real, you know. But that is the true point of being an artist, is, you know, and I tread this subject lightly with other people. I feel like I don't have to tread it lightly with you. You know, because other people are like, well, you know, to truly be the artist is to embrace the pain. I feel we are here to absorb the world's pain and then shoot it through a prism and project that on each and every individual's heart.
I love
that. That is our goal. That is our job as the artistic community. Now, are there other, I never pour salt in another person's hustle. Like if you're out there and you're making your dollars with your yo-yo and, you know, do you be a mumble rapper. It's cool. I don't care. I'm about my lane. That's what I really, really dig about you as a human and as an artist. You are engaged enough to actually live the art. And you know, we're talked about it, but we haven't actually come out and addressed the elephant in the room. You have stated, you know, you prayed about it, and you know, God had told you that this is the message for it, you know, and I am someone of faith as well, so I truly understand this. But let's peel that back, because a lot of our listeners are going to want to categorize that into a singular pigeonhole. And from what I know about you just engaging in this conversation, you are not a pigeonhole person. So let us talk about that faith, how you categorize it, if it can be categorized. Because trust me, faith at some points can't be categorized. It's just what I believe. And in no way, understand that this is 100% of a safe space. We will not ever tell anyone that they believe wrong, because you cannot believe incorrectly. Your beliefs are your right, period. You can believe what you want to believe. But let's engage in that. Let's talk about, you know, what your faith is, because it is such a huge influence on your art. So let's get there.
Well, first I want to say, and addressing what you talked about that rawness of going through when you're, you know, sharing with people your art in such a raw way, and having to relive that in a live setting. That's one of the reasons why I think I don't like to do spoken word in that kind of environment, because there's so much different kind of energy in there. And also sometimes, like you just talked about a safe space, sometimes it doesn't feel so safe. And so, you know, you got to balance what you're opening up yourself to and giving, but also receiving. And mm-hmm. so that's, you know, that's a tricky thing to balance, and a tricky road to travel. And when it comes to one of the things that I talk about in the Surrender Remember piece is having to surrender ideas about what it means to be this gender. I think that's how I worded it. And there's so much that comes with the male identity mm-hmm. and what that is supposed to look like. And then you add race on top of it to toxify mm-hmm. it even more. Mm-hmm. and then you add, you know, this part of the world that we're living in and, you know, all of that. And so I have found that in my growth, personal growth process, that it has been a requirement to unburden myself of all mm-hmm. of that and to give myself the permission to be whoever it is that I need to be for the benefit of my soul, my spirit. And so how that has materialized for me is not being a part of a religious community in the sense that where the priority is following lines of any particular doctrine, mm-hmm. but just really simply being a part of spaces and places, whether public or private, where people are prioritizing love, hearing kindness, you know, and so that is where that's what I have sought out in my interactions and my relationships and friendships. Going even further as far as, you know, discovering, giving my space, myself the space to sort out what my sexuality looks like within mm-hmm. My spirituality, how those two connect. And I also have found in that space that it's not black and white, you know, mm-hmm. it's a spectrum that's not necessarily defined in the ways in which we tend to define it with labels.
I spend a lot of time reaching out to people and apologizing for the book that people have weaponized for so long. And there is there that reality. And when, mm-hmm. you know, any type of anything is based upon a singular book, and people will then distort the teachings in that book mm-hmm. to force their own agenda. Mm-hmm. If we do not take the time to apologize for that, if we do not take the time to recognize that, if we do not take the time to understand that, you know, the Spanish Inquisition was a horrible thing. Like, yeah, see, I even went there. I have no problem having uncomfortable conversations, and anyone who wants to confront me about it, I'll be a set of blues on July 1st. It's cool. I don't run from these things. Mm-hmm. But the Spanish Inquisition was wrong, you know, because you promote bloodshed from a book about peace and love. That's mm-hmm. an issue. You know, and this continues to happen. You know, people have contorted what is said in the Bible to justify the Ku Klux Klan. People have contorted what is said in the Bible to marginalize the LGBTQ plus community. This is a problem. And I have been blessed with, you know, going into a ministry that allows me to go into those communities and say, hey, I'm sorry. And just from those moments alone, the healing that can happen. And there's been times I've been told exactly where to stick it. And you want to know something? Because of the trauma and the pain that was tied to that book, to that person that it was weaponized against, I take it.
Yeah.
Because I know it's not me personally.
Right.
It's
right.
all the people that came before that told them they were less than because of a book.
Mm-hmm.
It's not cool. And again, people have a problem with it. Send all the hate mail to Preston. It'll be fun.
I really enjoyed where this conversation took us. This was my first time speaking with Easy Blues, and I have to say, it was a pleasure, my friend. Thank you for allowing me the space to share and making sure it was comfortable to do so. And Preston, this really was a prestigious experience, one that I didn't see coming, yet I'm so glad it happened. Thank you for taking me on this journey behind the brand.
Heel, thank you for being a part of the program. I really do appreciate it. And I hope I open the door to new people getting introduced to you, because you have such a great mind and you're such a great personality to know, Heel. So I'm really happy to have this experience with you. And I hope to have it again very soon.
I'm Akil Johnson, the poet god. Thank you for listening.